So hi, I'm definitely very appreciative for the opportunity to be here and speak with you today. I am going to cover, I guess the way to look at it would be what the potential is for the world right now, the potential that the U.S. has to change our idea of what productivity means in a completely major way, a real 180, or a real jump to a new dimension, and how we can put that into practice. I'd want to start by talking about, part of this new scenario that we're in. Now, a lot of people have heard about the fake news, that apparently Vladimir Putin actually controls all of the media in the United States. That Vladimir Putin controls your very thoughts, and it's Vladimir Putin who caused you recently to switch from chocolate to strawberry ice cream as your favorite. They say Vladimir Putin ran the whole thing. He destroyed Hillary Clinton. He put Donald Trump in office. Well, as Diane Sayre put it in her really excellent article in the Hamiltonian that's being printed right now, or that's out now, sometimes you miss what you're looking for when you look in a too specific way. People who are saying, did Vladimir Putin shape the US election by looking at whether Russian secret services, read the Podesta emails and then released them, they're kind of missing the point. Yes, Vladimir Putin shaped the US election. Yes, Xi Jinping shaped the U.S. election. Yes, Lyndon LaRouche shaped the U.S. election. Yes, we shaped the U.S. election. President Modi of India shaped the U.S. election. The United States is a country that exists in the world, I believe. And things that change what's going on in the world, these have an effect on the United States. So let's ask something different. What created the opportunity for a major international influence on the US election and look at it in the standpoint of other elections. So, what's been going on in the world over the past few months? The United Kingdom, there was a vote for the Brexit. This was astonishing. If you looked at the kind of media coverage that occurred in England when this vote happened, people said, this couldn't be. How could anyone be so stupid as to vote for the Brexit? All the experts told them it was a bad idea, but then they did it. Why? The people are morons. That was the kind of coverage. What happened in France just now? François Fillon won the primary for the Republican Party in France to run for president. What's his policy? To stop being confrontational towards Russia, among other things. What happened in Moldova? What happened in Bulgaria? People are winning national election saying, let's work with Russia. Let's not oppose Russia and China the way the United States has been intent on doing. In South Korea, the president there, who had been opposing cooperation with North Korea, who had been supporting the placement of US missiles in South Korea, something that was strongly opposed by China, well, she's now about, looks like she's about to get impeached. The Philippines, people have heard President Duterte's strong language at times, calling President Obama the son of a whore. He told him that God, he announced that God told him to stop swearing so much, so he promised he'll cut back on his language. But this is a country that was long strongly connected with the US and is now taking an independent position in its interests. What are the interests of the Philippines? What does the US have to offer the Philippines right now? What does China have to offer the Philippines right now? Which country is going to be able to put in place helpful economic programs to cooperate in a regional development to get the Philippine economy and people living better? Is it the US or is it China? You'd have to be blind not to say, hey, there's a lot of potential here coming from what China's doing. And then just one other thing, this was after the US election, the APEC meeting in Peru, the Asian Pacific Economic Cooperation meeting. At this event, Obama didn't have much to say. He was officially a lame duck at that point. But who spoke? Xi Jinping spoke about the opportunities being presented by the One Belt, One Road. Duterte spoke. And after that meeting, Chinese President Xi Jinping, what did he do? He stayed in Latin America. He was in Peru. He went to Ecuador. He went to Chile. The president of Ecuador said this was the biggest event in the history of Ecuador. That's how excited they were that Xi Jinping came to speak about cooperating on a science city, to speak in Peru as he did, about the bio-oceanic corridor, about a connection, a rail link from the Pacific to the Atlantic in South America. So there's a lot that's going on. I want to give an example. This is a conference that took place on Wednesday in Washington, D.C. It's the same day as our trip to the Congress. This was a forum, US and China Belt and Road Forum. So it was a discussion about China's One Belt, One Road project, which I'm about to get into. And it had Chinese speakers, it had Americans responding to it. So there's this panel, you know, the American response to the Silk Road. What is America's response to China's policy going to be? And as came up very clearly, people kept saying, well, the US doesn't have much to offer. The US might lecture a country about human rights. Okay. That's about all that, I mean, what else do we have, really? We do make a lot of weapons, so, you know, people can buy weapons from us, although not the Philippines. They're buying them from Russia now. But what's there to offer? To tell countries, don't develop, you're going to create global warming gases? As the moderator pointed out, she said, look, you're not going to get anywhere with developing countries when you tell them they can't develop. What do we have to offer? In contrast, China has been signing, you know, hundreds. The Export-Import Bank of China is involved in over 1,000 projects right now with neighboring countries. China is engaged in over 20 energy products with its neighbors, 20 major energy projects with its neighbors. Trade's increasing, development's improving. China has lifted 700 million people out of poverty in the past few decades. That's a lot there. And it was sort of like looking at things through a bizarro lens, because what did the American participant, the expert, the professor have to say? He said, well, sounds like geopolitics. I think China is trying to use its influence to reshape the world around it. The Chinese people say, well, yeah, of course that's going to happen. But that's not the reason for doing all of this. It was like it was impossible to even conceptualize that China isn't lying when they say, let's have a win-win paradigm. Let's work together so we both benefit. It's just that doesn't even compute. It's really shocking. So at this event, it was a lot of fun. You may notice this report, which looks a little bit similar to another report you may have seen. I think it's not an accident, given how much the work of the LaRouche movement, of Lyndon and Helga LaRouche over the decades, has gone into shaping what is now Chinese policy. What was announced in 2013 by President Xi Jinping in Kazakhstan as the Belt and Road Initiative. That work over the decades from the LaRouche's, well, I'll show a better picture of it. One more thing about this event. Anyone recognize this guy? Jim Woolsey, former CIA director. He came to show up and say, I'm so glad that we can work with China. Under the Trump administration, we'll be able to work together as collaborators and friends because China is civilized, not like those barbarian Russians. Yeah. So it's like you're not going to be able to pull China and Russia apart from each other. He also said that one of the big ways that China and the United States could cooperate would be on alternative fuels like methanol, because that way we can crush the power of the diabolical regimes of Iran and Russia. It's just bizarre. A conference that's speaking about building things like roads where they're gravel right now, water treatment systems, natural gas pipelines, high-speed rail, and the best you can bring is turning food into gasoline. It's a little bizarre. So here's what I want to go over. I want to talk about what physical economics is, as seen by LaRouche. I want to talk about the projects of this new Silk Road, this World Land Bridge proposal that the LaRouches and the LaRouche movement have been advocating for decades, and talk about how to finance it, something that's coming up quite a bit right now, and about what we can do here. So I think a lot of you have probably seen this before. But it's always good to think about it in a fresh way. This is the number of human beings on the planet over time. That doesn't happen for any other form of life. Not that I'm aware of. It's probably true for cockroaches or pets.
Ants.
Ants? Anything that lives in our houses with us, maybe kitty cats, maybe they're going up too. More people, more cats, more puppies, you know, less coyotes. So the way this happens is that unlike the animals, we're not animals. I mean, our bodies resemble animals, sure. But what makes human society human is that we transform how we live every generation. No animal does that, and every person in this room, each of us, is human in that way. Our mind is the same as the mind of anybody else as a potentially creative discoverer of something new that'll totally transform how we live in the future, which is exactly how children are treated by the school system today. Not quite. So this story of the human identity, this goes back to Greece, and I'll be brief because I know a lot of people have heard this story several times, but I mean, the creation story in Greek mythology, the creation story of the human species, it's Prometheus. It's not just the creation of human bodies. It's the creation of the human mind. In fact, Prometheus, who, as the story goes, took fire from Zeus in heaven and gave it to human beings, well, he described what people were like before they were people. He described what we would be like if we were animals. Prometheus says that before the gift of knowledge, he said, we had eyes to see, but we didn't understand. We had ears to hear, but to no avail. And that we lived like swarming ants in caves, ignorant of the seasons, ignorant of the time to plant and to harvest. We were animals. Prometheus says, but I gave fire, and that made mankind. And it wasn't just fire. What else are the gifts of Prometheus? The alphabet, astronomy, the calendar, using animals to help us do our labor, using sailing ships. These are all things that he describes, creating metals, metallurgy. This all is the idea of this is what makes us human. This is the creation of the human species, not as animals, but as creative figures. That's who we are. So as a concept that we can use to think about where we move into the future, think about what we're able to do. Think about at any point in the past, in history, there's an infinite number of things that could be done by a person on some given day. You wake up in the morning, you're in ancient Egypt. There's really, you know, you could do a whole bunch of things. You could write a poem, you could, if you were a slave, maybe there weren't that many things you could do, actually. But maybe you could still, what might you be thinking about? You can occupy your mind, you can do this, you can do that, you can make a painting, etc. You can't microwave a burrito. You can't get antibiotics. Right? So although there's always an infinite number of things, there's never a limit to what people can do at any time, we still can make that infinite bigger. We still increase the potential platform of what we can accomplish. So fire you can cook with. Charcoal you can make metal with. Steam by burning coal, now you can make motion. You can dig something out of the ground and turn it into motion. Seems like magic almost. With chemistry, we develop substances that never existed before. Aluminum, for example. With electricity, we make things happen that never occur. Electricity is in nature. Maybe you see a lightning bolt, but a lightning bolt never goes through a motor and causes something to turn to, you know, produce something in a factory. Right? It's unique to us. The nuclear world, which we have not developed. The potential in a nucleus, right? A nucleus is a million times smaller than a molecule. But a nucleus has a million times more power than a molecule. A million times more energy potentially in a nucleus than in a molecule, like natural gas, methane. We've only scratched the surface of what we can do with that understanding. We've got some nuclear power plants, but we've not developed the next generation of where that ought to go with fusion. And we see this when we look at our fuel use over the energy use over the existence of the United States. Overall, the amount of energy used per person has increased up until about the time of Kennedy's assassination. The kind of fuel that we use changes from wood to coal. All the things you can do with wood, you can do with coal and then some. No one was going on a rail trip with someone putting wood chips in the locomotive. They were using coal. No one's running their airplane on coal, right? They're using petroleum products for that. What we could be doing with nuclear, we just really haven't done in terms of what it could have been. I mean, this was a projection from the time of Kennedy's administration of where they expected per capita energy use to go. Did we just get more efficient? Are all of our factories that are churning out half the world's manufactured goods, like in the 1940s, are they just more efficient now? Are we making half the world's manufactured goods anymore? No way, right? In plants? Right. I mean, some of these things are just, they're almost no-brainers. Like, this is a chart of electricity use per capita with GDP per capita, right? You can't develop without electricity. So when Obama goes to South Africa and says, I'm sorry, but you can't all have cars and air conditioning here because if you do, the planet will boil over, which is what he told a group of college students in South Africa, he's saying, sorry, you can't develop. Now, if you don't have power, you're not going to be developed. It's not going to happen. And we see this in the world. The darkness in so many places, some of it's geographical. Deserts are a tough place to live. The whole continent of Africa is not a desert. I don't know if anybody knew that, took geography class, right? Yes, there's, you know, desert up here. This is underdevelopment, right? Desert and underdevelopment. So there's a lot of growth, there's a lot of room to grow in the world. I think I already covered that, I'm not gonna show it again. This is what I wanna say about that next level of power. So the way we do nuclear energy right now is we break apart uranium or thorium or plutonium. We break apart the nucleus and that releases energy. Way better is when we put together two small nuclei to make energy. This is one of the ideas of going to the moon. On the moon, there's a special kind of helium, helium-3, that is just, it just basically doesn't exist on Earth at all. Does anybody know why it's on the moon and not on Earth? Why?
The Earth's field shields the Earth from ejection of helium-3.
Yeah, the sun is making, the sun is where the helium-3 is coming from. None of it gets here. We have a magnetic field. The Earth, the moon doesn't. So it's just, it's collecting in the crevices and it's just sitting there on the moon. As a fuel, it's over a million times more energy dense than gasoline, for example. A million times. So, can we use it right now? No, only in a bomb. We cannot use fusion except in, you know, huge explosions at present. We don't know how to use it in a power plant. And it's on purpose that we don't. Here's a chart made in the 70s. Different amounts of funding for fusion and when it was expected that we'd make the breakthrough. This level of funding was expected to never make the breakthrough. And this is how much money has been dedicated to fusion research in the United States. But think about how much money has gone into making a slightly more efficient windmill versus the unbelievable payback that we would get from developing fusion power. Why would that not be done? It's intentional. It has to be intentional. So, in terms of thinking about what infrastructure is, it's a platform that our thoughts become flesh. Our thoughts become real. They become physical. We make discoveries. The scientist makes the discovery. How do we make that something that we apply in our life to change how we live? Well, one of the big ways is infrastructure. How do we move everything around? Are we moving everything with horses and carriages? What level of development can you possibly reach with that? Are we moving everything with magnetically levitated floating trains that go 200 miles an hour? That's a big difference. Is the power that we're using incredibly expensive, like solar panels? Or is it incredibly cheap, like fusion power will be, or like nuclear can be right now? Right? It has an impact on the whole economy. And so that's, I think, the point to make about productivity. If you ask a typical economist, they'll say, we measure productivity by how much money did you make? Think about outsourcing. When a factory is taken from, let's say, the Detroit area to someplace in Mexico, or someplace in Vietnam, a textile factory, let's say, even if you move all of the equipment, even if the, you know, the production process is the same, what makes it more productive to have that factory in Mexico or Vietnam? Is it because the power is cheaper? The workers are more skilled? They're just paid less. Right? It's not any more productive. In fact, it's less productive if you're shipping the goods back to the US. It's less productive physically, of course. So instead of measuring things in terms of how much money do we save by making a change, think about, are we increasing our ability to produce? Are we increasing what Alexander Hamilton called the productive powers of labor? Can we do more now, thanks to some change that we've made? Can we achieve more, thanks to some change that we've made? Can we raise standards of living and give people access to a meaningful life where they know that in the future they'll be able to say, hey, I really did something? Or is it just cheaper to get something at Walmart? Right? There's a real sense of productivity. So I want to take a very quick tour of what this is looking like in those nations that have adopted it. This report of ours that that came out in 2014, The New Silk Road Becomes the World Land Bridge, this is the result of decades of work. The first report by EIR on the Eurasian Land Bridge that came out in the 1990s laid out a proposal for, now that the Cold War is over, here we go, we got a copy, you know, how can we work together with nations? Okay, 97, here we go, right? And this was the blueprint. This was, here's how the world can cooperate together. Here's the specific kinds of projects. Here's a new way of relating between nations. How do you relate to your neighbors? How do you pay for things together? What should you do in common? And it's now becoming a reality. So here's our updated World Land Bridge. And the year before this report came out, right, 97, you know, here's Helga LaRouche, the eastern terminal of the new Eurasia Land Bridge. She's known as the Silk Road Lady in China. When she's interviewed on TV there, that's how they introduce her. Because they know that although this is China's policy now, it had an origin. Right? She was over there saying, this has got to be your policy. And it worked. The ideas of a reasonably small group of people, good ideas, actually can make a difference. China's the biggest country on the planet. That's a pretty good ally to have. So it started as official policy of China, September 2013. President Xi Jinping at Nazarbayev University in Kazakhstan announced what he called the One Belt, One Road, or the Belt and Road Initiative in English, or the new, the Economic Silk Road and anyway, it doesn't really matter. Okay, the 21st Century Maritime Silk Road and the Silk Road Economic Belt. That's the official policy of China. And here's what it really could become. So here's China. Here's high-speed rail. China didn't have any high-speed rail a decade ago, kind of like us today. So maybe we can do as good a job as they did. China currently, he's got 20,000 kilometers of high-speed rail, 12,000 miles of high-speed rail. And it's nice. It goes 300 kilometers an hour, so that's about 180 miles an hour. That's a little bit faster than Amtrak.
Is there any of it maglev?
No. Well, sort of. In Shanghai, there's a train that goes from the airport into Shanghai that's maglev. And there's also another maglev route that was imported from Germany. So Transrapid is a German company that developed a maglev train. China's their only customer. In Shanghai, they bought a maglev train from them. Now China since has been developing its own internal domestic maglev capabilities, which is now under construction. I forget the name of the city, but yes, they are now starting to test and build their own maglev. See, if they wanted to build a lot of it, they're not going to afford to buy it all from Germany. So what they've been doing is they've been developing, doing the research they can build it themselves. Same with the high-speed rail they've got right now. These aren't imports. At first they did, but now it's basically all Chinese domestic manufacture. The train sets, the engines, they're producing the components, they're building it themselves. And so now they're starting to do that with maglev because it took them some time to develop the knowledge to make that possible. But yeah, so they're...
Isn't China about the same size as the United States?
Yes.
Territory?
Yes, yes. Yeah, you know, and their plan is to have, in 10 years, they plan to double this. 38,000 kilometers of high-speed rail, that's their plan. And they just do it. Like every year, people say, you know, if you're, you know, people who live in China, every year, maybe they want to go on vacation or visit relatives or something like this. And they say, oh, what do you know? There's a new high-speed rail line open. Instead of taking 14 hours, like to go from Beijing to Xi'an, nowadays it takes 6. That's a pretty big improvement. A 14-hour train ride, that's not very pleasant. Right? So, and they did it all. They did it all in a decade. They've also built several dozen metro lines. I think about 2 decades ago, China, you know, had maybe, I think, less than a dozen metro lines in its country. Now there's several dozens. And they're just building this stuff. They're spending $1 trillion every year on infrastructure. Here's a water project that they've got to bring water from the Yangtze River up to the Yellow River. You know, if you have floods here and droughts here, by managing the water in the country as a whole. Because as you pointed out, China's the same size as the US. I think it gets 40% less water that comes in. So it's amazing that they've got as many people as they do with so much less water than the United States has. And you know. No, they don't. I mean, much of the US water is not used. I mean, if you think about all the water that's in Alaska or the Pacific Northwest, it's just going in rivers and straight out to the ocean. You know, we've got, these are huge rivers. Whereas in China, there's a lot more opportunity to use it along the way. I think that's a difference. But no, I don't think they're very big on desalination at present. I'm not sure. This is a proposal that LaRouche was at a conference for this back in the, either, I think in the 90s. Thanks. About building a canal through Thailand. Now, right now, I think about, what's the number? I think either a third, I wrote it down, 1/4 of all world goods go through the Straits of Malacca on ships, 1/4. And it's basically, in a dozen years, it's going to be at capacity. There's just no room for any more ships going through there. It's pretty narrow. There's only been so much ship traffic you can get through before you get traffic jams. So what's the solution going to be on that? Well, building a canal through Thailand, for one thing, it would save 400 miles. So figure how fast a ship goes. You know, maybe that'll cut a day off of your journey. And it would be an opportunity for development in the area, too. I mean, all these things that are near ports, it's just a great place for, you know, things that are working straight on shipping to be, but also just any sorts of industry. Because you're there, you got easy access to things. So it would be a development project. This whole region is estimated to need $10 trillion of infrastructure. Asia, Southeast Asia. Russian rail proposals, including this one here. This leads somewhere. Right? Sarah Palin's house. Here's a view of the world from the North Pole. So these aren't just squiggly lines drawn everywhere. I mean, what these all represent, in fact, I want to say something about that in particular with this one. So the Suez Canal. So over the course of a year, Egypt basically doubled the width of the Suez Canal. There was a portion of the canal that was only one lane wide, so ships would have to wait for other ones to go by. And now it's double width the whole way. So ships can go north and south, they can cross each other, they don't need to wait for the other one to pass. Now, just building a canal is good, but the real thing that Egypt was excited about was developing the region economically in general. They're saying, hey, this is a great place to set up industries. A lot of companies would love to have a location here. They can easily get things from shipping that's coming from the Mediterranean, that's coming from Asia this way. It's right there, ready for you to grab. You can process it, and then you can re-export more valuable things now. You know, you can do something productive there. That's the image for what has to be done. It's not only connecting places, but along the way, that means that you can then develop. You know, if you're able to produce things that can then get somewhere, they all just became more valuable. if it, things are spending less time sitting on a ship, just, you know, traveling on the ocean, it becomes more valuable. There's less stock of goods just sitting on a ship somewhere. It's just more productive. Crossing the Strait of Gibraltar. Right now, Spain is at the end of Europe. It could be in the middle of Europe and Africa instead. These aren't huge things to build. This is a much bigger one. Building a connection from Italy to Tunisia. Right. These are the types of things being planned. How to finance these? Here's an example. China financed a project, a rail line, from Addis Ababa to Djibouti. And it reduced the travel time by, you know, less than half now. At least it take a couple of days. Now it takes 10 hours for a passenger train. China basically financed that project. It'll be paid back over a long period of time with domestic workers and some Chinese workers too. It, you know, this is the type of project where when China says win-win, they mean it. It was very straightforward. They said, you could use a railroad. We'll finance it and build it for you. You'll benefit from it, from the benefits of having it. You can pay us back over time. It's just almost such plain common sense. And you say, well, what has the United States helped fund of this sort in Africa? What might a US NGO do? Say, we'll send you a foot-powered water pump or a solar panel put on the roof of your hut. That's appropriate technology, they would say. You know, people are people. Okay, I don't want to go through every 2 minutes. Okay, here's another one, right? Refilling Lake Chad. That would be an excellent project. Crossing, you know, the old railroads in Africa were generally, you know, colonial ones, just meant to take things from mines and export them to the ports. There's no continental rail system in Africa. That's now proposed. That'll transform the continent. Right, so there's all these, oh yeah, right, in the Bering Straits. Russia and the United States are pretty close, relatively speaking. Things could get from one place to another a whole lot quicker traveling on a high-speed train than by taking the ocean route. This would be a great way to work with Russia. Right? So, oh yeah, again, here's this comparison. United States and China, about the same size. This is clearly not an honest map on the left, because this is supposedly high-speed rail, and if you've taken it, you know it isn't. Yeah. It's just embarrassing. What's that? I don't know who made this claim. It's not. I mean, no international body would call it high-speed rail, I don't believe. Well, yeah, I mean, the thing is, I think there's actually like a small portion up here where it goes over 100 miles an hour.
The legend calls that the best we got
for this. Oh, best? Okay, there we go. Right. Right. You know, we could have a full national network on this. I mean, the Northeast Corridor is a no-brainer. Absolutely, we should upgrade the rail in the Northeast Corridor. It's heavily traveled, you know, double-digit increase in ridership over the past decade. You know, it's a great way to... I think that now the estimates are that most people going from D.C. to New York take the train. It'd be great if it was a little bit quicker. It's a long trip, considering how close these cities are. I mean, if this was France or China, it wouldn't be a 3-hour-plus trip, right? Could be an hour and a half.
It's not the train, it's the rail, because it has to slow down in certain parts of when it leaves Maryland. It's not going to its full potential.
Yeah, well, it doesn't have dedicated track. Like in China, these high-speed rail lines, these are for high-speed passenger rail. That's what those lines are for. They're not sharing it with freight trains that are, you know, sitting here and then the Amtrak has to go off on a siding and wait for it. Yeah, none of that. It's dedicated rail, you know, that costs money. It's an investment. So yeah, the Northeast Corridor, absolutely. But how about the whole country? We could transform transportation this way. Now this would mean that we'd have to really gear up our industry because we can't build this stuff. We have to gear up our power production because how are we going to power electrified train travel of this sort? You know. Right. So we've put together a lot of these proposals in this LaRouche-Pack pamphlet, The U.S. Joins the New Silk Road, that goes through what would it look like in the U.S.? What will our participation in a new paradigm of economic development look like? Well, I'm just, you can ask about this in the questions if you want. I feel like I've got too many graphics here. But, you know, water is another aspect of it. Right now, like, for take food, for example. We don't just walk around and if we find food, we eat it and hope that we get by during the day like that. Right? We grow food. We have agriculture. We don't just look for it or go fishing. We create it. Unfortunately, with water, that's pretty much what we do. Oh, it fell here. That's wonderful. Good. Our crops are doing well. And, you know, and we supplement that. We use groundwater, you know, for irrigation and for cities. We install dams on rivers to control flooding, keep the water supply more constant, and then divert it to agriculture. We do that. But the water that falls in the Pacific Northwest, where it's in great abundance and isn't doing anybody any good, including nature or life or anything, I mean, it's just going straight to the ocean. It's not helping a plant. It's just way too much water. Well, you know, what if that were brought to the Southwest instead? What if we could take the water from the oceans, where there's plenty of it? California's in a water crisis. There's a lot of water right next to California. Right? And desalination, even with current technologies, really is feasible. You could desalinate for the, you know, urban, like non-industrial, not agriculture, but just for the urban use of all the counties along the coast of California. I think the per capita power requirement for that would be about 100 watts. It's not a lot to do this kind of thing. The capital cost, bringing it out over 30 years for the investment, I think would be a few hundred dollars per family, even with current technology. So this stuff is doable. Oh, yeah. Okay, all right. Now, how are we going to pay for all that? Because this is going to cost a fortune. All right, Donald Trump said he's going to spend $1 trillion on infrastructure. It's not enough. That's one thing. And how is it going to be financed? Where is this $1 trillion going to come from? How's it, you know, what's it going to be? So some of these proposals are repatriating U.S. corporate profits held overseas, saying, okay, we've got a 35% corporate tax rate, but we'll drop it to 15%, you know, 10% if you bring back the money right now. Bring it back, repatriate it, we'll only charge you 10% tax, and that's money that we'll set aside for infrastructure. Okay, so there's an idea. Another one is to set up and raise money from private investors, you know, sell bonds and this sort of thing. The thing is that if you're trying to get investors who are used to playing big money on, let's say, the stock market, and you're saying, we'd like you to set your money into something that won't turn a profit for 20 years, that's a difficult sell. Where is money in the banking system going right now? Like from 2007, 2008 to 2014, $15 trillion in bailouts, loan guarantees, et cetera. $15 trillion was made available to the U.S. banking sector. Bank lending that left the finance sector into the real economy decreased during that period, right? So if you're saying we're going to somehow get people to want to invest in this, what are the only projects you're going to be able to build are ones that are going to pay for themselves very quickly, the low-hanging fruit, right? The toll road, the new airport expansion, you know, you're going to charge per capita, you know, per person flying through an airport. People flying through an airport can, you know, probably afford an extra $5 for their flight. You're not going to build a national program that way. So what we could do is, for one thing, join the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank. I mean, Chinese people, Chinese government officials are a little bit dumbfounded that we didn't. Some of them say, the U.S. keeps saying that China isn't engaging in the world. Here we go, we set up an international infrastructure investment bank, and the U.S. doesn't join it. And the U.S. urges other countries not to join it. Right. So what's it going to be? Country-to-country deals, that's one thing that we can do. And what we really need to do is, let's go through Mr. LaRouche's proposal here, is what he calls his four laws. And these are in that Alexander Hamilton book that everybody can get a copy of. It ends with Mr. LaRouche's four laws to save the USA now. And they're pretty simple. First off, we need Glass-Steagall. That's number one. Without Glass-Steagall, you're just not going to be able to get any money as loans out into the real economy. It just stays in the financial sector. With Glass-Steagall, we can throw away all the gambling that's been done, throw away those losses, let banks go bankrupt if they're bankrupt. They went bankrupt legitimately. That's just too bad for them. And we can save commercial banking to make it possible to run the real economy. We need national banking. You know, this proposal, as Paul Gallagher had written up, of having the holders of treasuries. I mean, China and Japan each have $1 trillion in U.S. treasuries. What if a large portion of that could be brought in as stock in a new national bank to then have to be able to make loans off of? People holding U.S. treasuries are not currently expecting huge rates of return like a stock market gambler. What if we refinanced it at a higher rate over a longer term, set up taxes? Like maybe Bloomberg would set up a sugar tax to, you know, pay for that. You know, and then to be able to have this credit. And then here's the criterion. Are we increasing our energy flux density? Are we investing in things that make more productivity possible, that make the work of every person more valuable? So like potholes, for example. Should we fill potholes? Sure. But that's not a national program. You can't have a broad national program of fixing stuff we've already got and paving gravel roads. Maybe you should do that. But, you know, where is the high-speed rail? Where is the new power plants? And a crash program for fusion. This won't even cost that much. Compared to the amount that we spend on a lot of things, this is actually not even going to have to be that huge. But let's say it was. I mean, NASA at a certain point was 5% of the budget of the U.S. It was sure worth it, right? So that's the policy that we need. And let me go to, I don't want to keep just going on and on and on. Let me stop there. I want to see what kind of discussion or questions or thoughts people have. Sure. Let's take an example from agriculture. So this is what one of my friends, Bob Baker, was using as an example. He's talking about, let's say, corn. So he said, you know, how much can one person do in terms of planting corn and harvesting corn? So if you don't really have any tools at all, you're gonna be using a stick to make a hole in the ground and drop some, you know, corn in the ground. And there's a certain number of, like, in a day, you know, what can you get done with that kind of intensity? Then let's say you got a machine where it makes a hole and drops the corn in all by itself. Mm-hmm. Okay, so that's something. And then also look at what are you doing with the soil? Are you tilling the soil? Are you turning it over? Getting rid of the weeds so the corn grows more effectively and you get, you know, the nice soil underneath? Or how are you doing that? Are you doing that with, you know, you got an ox pulling a plow? Are you doing it with a tractor that's doing 16 rows at once? Or are you doing it without tilling? Do you have a tractor that's, you know, digging up an area, putting in the corn, packing it back down, et cetera? So if you look at what one person's doing, this is sort of a mixture of energy flux density and capital intensity. But one farmer, whether they're doing it with just their own body or using an animal and the capital intensity of the plow or doing it with that tractor, that one person is able to accomplish way more with their time. That's an increase in productivity that you would say, you don't even have to look at money to say that's an increase in productivity. That person is producing more. So overall, as economies develop, they head in the direction of more capital intensity, meaning you need more to do your job. The person working in a factory, they're not just doing something on their own, like some craftsman making something to sell at a county fair or something like that. Right, they rely on machines that are made over here, screws that are made over here, but you put that together and that one person is able to be very productive and make something that's very valuable with the effort that they put into it. So that's one way to look at it. How much are you able to concentrate effort and achieve more with it? Maybe very direct examples with cutting metals. You know, are you doing it with a metal blade that's just grinding up against it, or are you doing it with a laser?
Mm-hmm. One of the
things like, most people are familiar with hydroponic gardening.
Mm-hmm.
There is an offshoot of this called aquaponics, where tanks of fish are incorporated into the ecosystem, which works the plants. I directly know somebody who's doing this. And certain vegetables can have a new turnover, new bumper, every 3-4 weeks.
Mm.
That's an opportunity for better farming.
Yeah. Or think about vertical farming and the idea of having urban farming in buildings. I mean, if you've got, you know, I mean, let's say power prices are down to a cent or two a kilowatt hour. You know, you got your light growing lights on, it's no big deal. You got your indoor growing, there's no bugs, you don't have to worry about pests or weeds or anything like that. You only are growing what you want to grow. You don't have any dirt to worry about if it's hydroponic. Or you're just misting the roots, you know. So you can get really high quality produce that way. You know, people who are concerned about pesticides or whatever, there aren't going to be any on it because you don't need any. There's no pests. You don't have to do any weeding. So yeah, it costs a lot to get all that going. But then say, well, how are we going to feed people in the future? I mean, the amount of farmland on the planet is only but so much, and we've had tremendous increases in its productivity. But also at a certain point, you say, well, we're going to reach a level where it's going to be totally effective and make sense to just do it in buildings, the way we make things in buildings.
How much is the high-speed rail integration to Moscow?
No, I don't know that. I don't know beyond China's borders on that. Yeah. Yeah. No, I mean, there's these potential. I mean, you know, like Japan, for example, they've got a maglev company. You know, the ambassador from Japan, you know, was at a meeting in D.C. and he was announcing publicly, he's saying, hey, you know what? We'll finance half the cost of a D.C. to Baltimore maglev line. Half the cost financed by Japan. Couldn't get D.C. and Maryland and the federal government to be able to finance even half of it. So it just doesn't go anywhere. I mean, that's why it's just on a project-by-project basis compared to the way we need national banking to make it possible. I mean, why hasn't the stuff been built already is the other thing. Why did we let it get so far behind?
It seems to me like they're doing this purposely. There's a certain agenda that we just don't know about. And I wish we did so we could do something about it. They're doing this on purpose.
That's for sure.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, yes, at a certain point, if something gets screwed up bad enough, you got to say, is it really an accident? I mean, like the fusion thing, for example, and there's people who speak very explicitly about that, people who say the world should really only have 1 billion people. Well, of course they're not going to want fusion power. If you've got an ability to, you know, help develop the world more cheaply and easily, if you think there should be less people on the planet, you don't want that. Instead, say, no, let's put a lot of man hours into making a windmill or a solar panel. And you might say, does each individual windmill turn a profit based on financing its cost, how much electricity it makes? And maybe you'd say, sure. Or fracking, for example. Say, does this fracking well here turn a profit? Here's how much it costs me to do the fracking. Here's how much more hydrocarbons I got out of it. Was it worth it? It sort of misses the point sometimes, because you say, what are we doing as a society? What is the decision to go with fracking and trying to get more and more out that way? How does that decision compare with the decision to say, hey, why don't we get fusion power and stop wasting oil by burning it? I mean, like today, it seems a little bit weird to burn wood, because we do other things with wood, like make chairs out of it and things like that, or, you know, furniture and houses. It seems odd. Like, why would you? That tree took all that time to grow. Why would you just burn it? Coal is not much else you can do with it, but oil is what we make plastics out of. In 100 years, people are going to say, you guys were just burning all of your plastic reserves instead of making materials out of them? Why did you do that? It's so much more useful now. We have fusion for our power. We don't burn our, you know, all of everything we got made out of plastic. We use it to make things.
You have to have
Well, that's true. That's true for the reducing it. Yeah, yeah, that's true. That's a chemical process, and that's something that with the temperatures available, infusion might also be possible to get around that. Because if you're able to actually just get everything, so if you're able to dissociate the iron from the oxygen by just, you know, getting it, basically vaporizing it, or I'm forgetting the word. Yeah, getting it into a plasma, then, you know, maybe then you could pull the oxygen apart. Because you're right, otherwise, yeah, we need the coal to make the coke to have the carbon to pull the oxygen out of the iron ore. So we just have the iron. So, yeah, that's true. But in terms of it being intentional, I mean, there's been, you know, and I'm not as well versed on the specifics as I wish I were, but after the Cold War ended, there were definitely people who thought, well, you know what? The U.S. doesn't really need a strong industrial base anymore because it's over. We don't need to be able to supply ourselves in that way back when the Soviet Union was around. So we've had a policy over decades now where we've lost our ability to produce. Could nobody see that was a bad idea physically? And so, like I'm saying, like this, at this forum, this China One Belt, One Road US forum, these Americans really didn't have anything to say about what could the US offer on this.
It does seem that the oil industry and the banking industry has big power in the whole world. And they're putting pipelines in everywhere. And when they put these pipelines in, they make them so that they leak. They actually make them so that they leak because they also own the cleanup crew and they also own inspection, and they also don't clean up everything that they're supposed to. They bury it, and then it's poisoning the people around them because they're actually making money off of these spills.
Well, I think what you say about the banking sector is definitely very, very true. I mean, what does empire look like today? I mean, in the past it was a little bit more direct. When in the 1800s, Britain, you know, showed up at Hong Kong with gunboats and said, you are going to import opium or else, that was pretty direct. You know, when England controlled India and said, you're ours now, that's pretty direct. The colonial period, oh, you know, colonialism all over the planet. I mean, you know, pretty much every place on the planet. Like half the world has got a reason to hate Britain, you know, for some point in its past history. But what would empire look like today? There we go, right, and today and where is the, now how are drugs, right, the drug banks are the, well, anyway, it's true. You know, it's financial now. Now empire is of a financial form, where you, countries are, like consider the building of this new development bank in the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank. Now currently, China itself lends out more for investment in foreign nations. China invests more in foreign nations' infrastructure than the World Bank does. The World Bank for Reconstruction and Development lends out less money for infrastructure every year than just China. So there's just a tremendous need. Say, well, how are we going to finance all of these projects? How's it going to be done? And as was brought up at this forum, these countries know that the IMF, the International Monetary Fund, and the World Bank are not going to finance these projects. They know that the World Bank is going to say, we're not going to help build a coal plant because of global warming. Whereas, take for example, Sri Lanka. You know, China, I mean, the electricity rates in Sri Lanka were about 30 cents a kilowatt hour. Over the course of a couple of years, China built a coal-fired power plant in Sri Lanka. And now the prices are down to 11 or 12 cents. That's a dramatic improvement. That's a thing that helped all those people live much better, not have to spend so much money of their, you know, of their means on purchasing their electricity. That's something the World Bank would never have paid for because it would say, oh, no, no, we don't want to encourage you to do that because you're going to cause global warming. We don't want you to develop that way. No. So, and they know it. So the IMF and the World Bank, they say, we'll give you a loan, but you've got to do all these things, and we're not going to give you that money. In contrast, the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank says, no, if it's a project that makes sense, we'll finance it, and we're not going to ask you to change how much you pay people's pensions in order to get a loan to build a railway. We're not going to connect it. So, Yeah, I mean, the financial empire of the world, that's the thing that's being crushed and rejected right now, where people are being told, you know, stick with the EU. They say no. People are being told, oh, you know, Russia's, you know, Putin is the devil incarnate practically or something. It's like, no, you know, we can work with Russia. And these countries like the Philippines are saying, hey, we can work with China. We'll be able to develop ourselves, have a better future for the next generation. Let's do it. What's the U.S. offering us? So, we got a lot of work to do to have something to offer the world. In a major way.
Very good at getting their foot in the door, too. I used to cruise, and you go to the eastern, the western, or the southern Caribbean, and every port you pulled into, the first thing you saw was this huge soccer stadium. And the Chinese built them all.
Uh-huh.
Every one of them they built. So they got their foot in the door, and that was the same thing with the rail line.
Yeah.
Which would have opened up a market for them. For one thing, plus it would improve the infrastructure of the river. So they're very good at getting their foot in the ground.
And contrast that with the kind of that's a good point. I just think about the way that so many of the U.S. institutions think about this, where they say, aha, they're trying to get their foot in the door, they're trying to get in there. I'm not saying you're saying that, of course, but that's how these U.S. institutions, they say, oh yeah, China's trying to get in there. Yeah, sure, of course China's trying to get in there. Why not? Say, oh good, we can work with you and develop some trade deals, and our economy benefits and your economy benefits, and our workers get something to do and your workers have something to do, and then we're more productive overall and live better. Well, what's so bad about doing that? That's the way you ought to work together with other countries.
Why aren't they doing
it? Yeah, right.
Right?
Mm-hmm. You're explaining the connection with consumption and infrastructure, on how the increase of various infrastructure increases consumption, and how that's vital for an economy.
Well, it reduces the price of everything. I mean, I think that's there's two aspects of it. One is if you say, look at what's already being made, and can we reduce the cost of, like you can do an estimate for any particular thing that someone ends up actually using personally, or that a business buys as, you know, one of its inputs for what it does. You could say, how much of that cost was transporting it? You can also say, how much of that cost was providing the energy for it? It's like that Sri Lanka example. Was that energy costing 30 cents a kilowatt hour, or 11 or 12? So you just make things, see, that's in money terms. Think about it in labor power. If overall you're able to reduce the physical cost in terms of people's involvement in moving things. So you've made a capital investment. People have done a lot of work to build a rail line. People have done a lot of work to build the train sets. People have done a lot of work to build the power plants, you know, to power the high-speed rail. Now that that's there, and thinking about how much that effort, you know, was, what's the effort required now to provide the electricity to run that train? What's the effort required to keep that train going? And then how much less effort is involved overall than it would have been to have a bunch of trucks, each with somebody driving that truck? The effort to produce all the petroleum and refine it for all of those trucks. It's just more, it's physically more productive when you've got that higher capital intensity. So what it means is that,
More free energy in the system for the human beings involved.
Exactly. So in that way, it just makes everything physically cost less, to the extent that the cost is transportation. The other thing is it changes the opportunities. I mean, if you are like some of these places that these new roads are going through, like in Kazakhstan or some place like this, if you're living in an area that has intermittent electricity, not a very good water system, and a gravel road, what are you going to be able to do? Are you going to say, oh, this is a great place for me to open up my air conditioner factory? Probably not. You're going to say, oh, I'm going to, do a little bit of farming, and there's just, what am I going to do here? Versus when you've got, a nice highway, nice paved road in front of it, you got power availability, and you say, hey, this just became more valuable. I can do something, I can have a tractor factory here, or a, chair, you know, whatever you might be doing. But just, you know, it's a higher level. Or even if you're a farmer, you say, hey, great. Now my food can get where it's going quicker. It's fresher. It's worth more. People are willing to pay more for my tomatoes. Because it took one day less because they weren't going down, you know, 100 miles of a gravel road.
And that's the real payback for infrastructure, not user fees. That's why the whole user fees idea is wrong.
Exactly. It doesn't look at how did you change the productivity of the whole economy. And, you know, and Paul had sort of corrected me in that interview about this quote. Maybe I misquoted from the Tennessee Valley Authority. But this, it is true that the Tennessee Valley Authority made that southeast part of the country more productive in such a way that the incomes went up, and the increase in income taxes attributable to the TVA was enough to pay for the TVA. Right? Regardless of direct paybacks or user fees, it's just more productive. If it's not more productive in that way, then it shouldn't be built. I mean, that's a real standard. I don't mean income tax in particular, but say, is the payback that the economy is able to do more? Does the benefit from it pay for the social effort and all the work that was involved in building it up in the first place? And if it does, say, yeah, that's the project. If you've got a project like that, you shouldn't say, oh, but we don't have any money, so we can't build it. Say, no, we know that this will make things more productive in the future. Let's figure out a way to finance it. Yes?
So I wanted to comment about solar because so many people keep talking about how solar is not ready. Solar's been raining around for decades, okay? And there are various types of solar panels. There's for electricity and those that create hot water.
Mm-hmm.
You would never use an electric panel in order to heat water. That's just not energy efficient. However, one panel that heats water would be perfect for the average house. Bottom line is, for the vast majority of houses, given the fact that or given you do not have trees around, a roof that is populated with solar panels can supply the vast majority of the power for that house. Where you run into problems is, you know, where you start trying to do things like heat hot water. Not with an electric power. If you are trying to run a central air conditioning unit, well, guess what? You know, quite want to have enough air. But it's interesting that there are air conditioners popping up, which are designed to be tied to the solar panel array on your house. Okay. And this is, I think, is where we need to attack. We need to, you know, there's a lot of big infrastructure things that need to be addressed. But at the low level, to start really pushing to get individual residences with panels, if the homeowners want, and pull people off of the grid. Not completely, you know, at least not initially, but a movement can be made forward. Now, the big problem with it at the moment is the way the national electrical code and the state electrical code are written. Many people are avoiding panels for this reason. That is this. Regardless of who puts the system in, if you're getting money back, if you're getting the rebates, or if they're getting the rebates and they're just sending you a bill every month, your small little system on your house, which they claim is not enough for your house, is pushing its extra energy out into the grid. Okay? So by state and federal electrical codes, if there is power loss in the area, say storm damage, or hits a telephone pole or whatever, and power is knocked out, your system, by these laws, must shut itself down. This is wise. Because when the repair crews come in to fix the damage, you're thinking they're working with a de-energized line. Right. Lo and behold, your system's energizing. Right? You need to come off of the grid. Okay. Heck with what everybody else is doing. You know, and you know, you basically make a large investment in the people. Like you do a lot of little numbers, you know, it's like, and how do people become millionaires? You sell one thing for $1 million, they sell a lot of little things that everybody wants to buy for $5.
Well, I think there's two couple things to look at. One is the is, I think maybe there's three things to look at. One is that, you know, homes are a significant user of power. They're certainly not the only one. For example, you know, I mean, a car factory, for example, couldn't possibly power itself by solar panels. The other thing is whether it reduces the capital cost of a national electrical grid. Given that you're going to need to have a backup supply, or you don't want people to just have power outages when the,
you know, when the sun isn't shining or there's bad weather, that sort of thing.
So
you have to measure out, you know, based on the size of the region that you're doing all this solar install, the connectivity of that grid, how much does it reduce the capital cost of having a power supply versus the variable cost of buying the natural gas or the coal or whatever. And I think that if we are looking at the, you know, the effective cost of building up this kind of thing, in other words, like, if we're thinking about how are we going to increase the energy flux density of the economy, how are we going to make ourselves more productive, how are we going to make it possible to do these new things that we need to do, like if we're building, you know, real state-of-the-line factories in the U.S., we're building high-speed rail locomotives, we're building nuclear power plants, you know, to power all these things, we're going to need a lot more power. I mean, a lot more power. And the amount of social effort, the amount of, like, the just the capital cost of it is just going to be much less with, say, nuclear on a whole level like that, and certainly much less once we get fusion, which that's the thing. So it's like researching in ways that gives us incremental improvements while avoiding spending the research on the thing that's going to be just a, you know, a total game changer.
It's just going backwards.
Yeah, it would,
you're going to solar, you're going to windmill. It's like, it's almost like people's idea of, you know, what technology is in general. You're not skipping to the next level of progress. You're just going backwards, essentially, and putting mankind backwards because the solar is just obsolete, and then it's become like this scam of getting people's mindset in money and saving money versus moving progress forward.
Right. What's your rebate you're going to get?
Right.
You can do it with the house line of credit, then you can deduct the interest on it. So this reduces the cost of the solar panel for you as a person. And then it's sort of like thinking about the individual fracking well. Instead of, well, how are we going to power a whole society? Is this the technology? Or like go back 200 years. Are we going to improve the design of windmills, which we use for grinding corn? Or, and in the process of doing that, overlook and not move to steam power? It would basically say, well,
I guess that's good that you got to grind, you know, 5% more corn with that windmill, but you could have had a train. You could have had a steam engine, you know?
Can I just say one thing?
Sure.
What I always like to say is that if you have a water shortage, and you're telling people, now every time it rains, run out there with a pail and we'll save all the water. Rather than say, well, let's develop a plan to take all this water coming from Alaska that's going out to sea. I mean, this, why talk about getting power out of sunlight as opposed to mastering the power of the reaction that fuels the sun in nuclear fusion?
Yeah.
That's what Lewis Schultz says.
Yeah.
It's the transformative effect of a breakthrough in man's understanding and control over the fundamental laws of the universe, and that's what nuclear fusion is.
Exactly.
So why aren't we doing that? Well, we could have done it years ago.
Well, we were. I'm sorry, I just got a butt in because I had something to say about the fusion. I apologize, I walked in late, I'm not sure what I missed, but some years ago I worked for a company that had multiple branches scattered around. One of our branches was up in Princeton, New Jersey.
Yeah.
And they were doing fusion work there. They were doing research, and every month we would get a new company newsletter and say with every different division where they're at, you know. Mm-hmm. And I remember we got to the point where we were, our part of the whole puzzle was to refine the process by which the naturally occurring fuel, the deuterium and the tritium, are extracted from water, okay, and storing that to use as fuel in the fusion reaction. The reactor was built, Tomahawk, believe it was the name of it.
Tokamak.
And the last newsletter I remember seeing said something about making great strides in the ability to extract and store the fuel. And all of a sudden, the brakes were broken. Everything got closed up. And we were there, we were on the cusp, but at least we were doing some cutting edge research. We ain't doing jack now.
No,
everybody's,
that's the problem.
In that regard, everybody's looking to CERN. Everybody knows what CERN is. That is the big crux. But yeah, to have a fusion reactor, speculation 2, 3, 4 for the entire country.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, that was at least the numbers that they were getting from
the
what's going on in Princeton. But again, it just evaporated. You know, there were like no more strides made. There was a deliberate, concerted, deliberate effort to squash
absolutely.
That.
Absolutely.
And
the money that China is investing in all these, that's great. A lot of that money they got from us.
This is a chart that was made in the 70s, and it was given different sorts of funding parameters. It was when it was expected to reach, you know, commercial fusions. They knew then that if this level of funding, we'd just never get there. And the black line is actual funding. So it's absolutely been deliberately. Just recently, so the PPPL, I think they don't even have anything going right now. They're upgrading one of their things. MIT had a reactor, Alcator, that
a few months ago reached the highest plasma density of any, you know, experiment ever. And then it was shut down the next week. There's no funding, it's just shut down. It's just it. ITER,
now,
you
is
know.
The NRC doing that?
Well, the DOE, I think, is involved with the fusion funding. No, it wasn't the NRC. No. Their funding's coming from the Department of Energy. Now, the NIF's a little bit different. They get money from the Defense Department, but they built it too small. I mean, they knew how big they should have built that laser ignition, the National Ignition Facility in California. In Livermore, they've got a facility where 192 lasers all come together to cause fusion.
And they built it
too small. And the scientists knew they wanted a bigger one, but they cut the budget, so it's almost like they wasted a huge amount of money instead of spending more and actually getting a good result, because NIF didn't create what they wanted it to. They built it too small. But yeah, there's just no financing on this. And so ITER, the big thing being built in France, it's supposed to be done in like another decade, but probably might be another 2 decades. It's just been taking forever to build. It's got, you know, 30 countries involved. It's very complex. It's already obsolete. You mentioned China and their fusion research that they're doing. So a tokamak is shaped like a donut, and it uses a magnetic field to hold sort of in the core of the ring. To hold the plasma, the fusion, the deuterium and tritium, and so they come together and do fusions. Well, these experiments that are run, they only usually last a couple seconds. Because the magnets, you know, maybe we did the experiment, you wrap a wire around a nail and you plug it into a battery, and it makes a magnet. These magnetic fields are so strong that the stuff will just melt if you leave it on more than a couple of seconds. So they do these experiments in a couple second bursts, that's it. And then you gotta let it cool down to do another experiment. Well, the tokamak that they've got in China uses superconductors. It doesn't get hot. You can run long experiments with it. We don't have a superconducting tokamak in the US, period. The only ones we've got in terms of research right now, because the MIT one is shut down, is Princeton, which is undergoing maintenance, and General Atomics in San Diego. That's it. So, you know, the PPPL one is, the one in Princeton. So it's just like, you know, that's our effort? No, it's clear. No, I mean, get this number up like the way when we said we're going to go to the moon and we did it, and it paid for itself, not in terms of money, although it did indirectly. It paid for itself in that we had a new economy. We had all those new technologies that came out of going to the moon. Did it pay for itself in terms of the economy being more productive as a result of them? Yes. And it paid for itself in a way that wasn't scalar. The payback wasn't in terms of what you paid to get it. Your payback is in new technologies that you couldn't, that didn't have a value in terms of the previous economy, because they weren't there. You know, that's an increase in productivity.
This thing about
solar panels. I've spoken to people who like solar panels, and they have no concept of how important it still is to an economy. I point out, tell them that you need coal or wood to make steel. Someone told me, well, we can find another, an alternative use, an alternative for steel. Okay.
Oh, yes.
The whole thing with consumption and infrastructure is that infrastructure has to increase consumption and also increase domestic consumption. When the British had their economic policy in Ireland and India, it decreased domestic commerce and consumption. There was no focus on infrastructure. Both of those countries suffered famines. At one point, India lost about like 37 million people because of a British economic policy that didn't concentrate on increasing consumption and domestic commerce. Windmills and solar panels will not increase domestic commerce or consumption. It's not going to increase the consumption that's needed for an industrial economy. Neither will it increase the consumption for future generations. It's something meant to cause the calamities like the famines in India and the famines in Ireland. It's not meant for population growth. Hmm.
Yes, that is true. I mean, the promotion of these policies by people who should know better is like telling a third world country, I'm sorry you're going to have to stay that way because it's not appropriate for you to use a coal power plant. I mean, even I read a study from Stanford recently that said that I think maybe about within the last 5, 6, 7, 8 years, solar panels finally produce more power than
it costs to make them. Which means that everyone installed before that is a net drain. I mean, just even in terms of energy terms, in terms of the loss of potential, in terms of, you know, not being what should be done, it's definitely a negative as a way of powering a whole economy. But let's,
the most ridiculous one is ethanol.
Oh, ethanol, yes.
It affects more diesel fuel. It makes 1 gallon. And all the other expenses have to just go to smile. It takes more diesel.
And you think about what you're doing, because you're taking, if you think about all the things that you can do with petroleum, you can make plastics out of it, you can burn it. Now, what can you do with corn? You can eat it. And you can't eat natural, you can't eat
petroleum. I mean, you're taking something that's at a higher level of use in the biosphere and degrading it to something you're just going to use for its, you know, burning power. I mean, it's a total negative. It's a negative policy where maybe some people
promote it, say, well, it's to, you know, reduce our dependence on foreign oil or whatever. But at a certain level, it's known that, of course, it's a negative economic policy. It's the way of saying, hey, if we do this, we're actually going to make the economy worse. And that's done. It is done on purpose. These decisions are done on purpose to destroy the country. I mean, destroying the United States is a major goal of, I mean, it's been a major goal of the British ever since the Revolutionary War before then. I mean, that was part of what caused it. I mean, what's the first grievance in the Declaration of Independence? That the king has refused his assent to laws that were necessary to promote the common good. I mean, England was not allowing the U.S. to develop. Said, don't go west beyond those beyond the mountains. Don't go past the Blue Ridge. Don't forget about the interior of the country. We don't want you going there, because then you're going to be independent of us in England. So don't go there. Stop. No development. Oh, you're building an iron foundry? Oh, we don't like that. No, sorry. You can't do that. So it was preventing development. And so since then, I mean, since the development up until, you know, look up until the time of Kennedy's assassination, overall the U.S. was undoubtedly a force of good in the world. I mean, the development that we got here, where a new country, the first modern republic, developed living standards beyond any other country on the planet, you know, had developed socially and economically and had, you know, developed its own science and everything, that was a tremendous achievement. And the relations with other countries, like under Franklin Roosevelt, were good. Roosevelt had fights with Winston Churchill all the time, where he said, you know, he'd say to Winston Churchill, you can't expect us to fight against Nazi fascism and the German Empire and let you keep your empire, do you? We're not going to do that. India's just not going to be yours, Winston. You know, and he pointed out specific things, I think, another theme that we've come upon. He was taking him to task, and he was saying, you know, to Winston Churchill, he said, look at the way you guys treat Africa. You're getting pennies out of it and keeping it down when you could be making millions. I sort of, the way I said that, it made it sound bad. His point was that instead of allowing the actual development and say, hey, look, if you develop these countries and you have trade relations with them and two developed countries trading with each other, that's great. Instead of letting it get there, you're just going to say, no, stay poor and do mining and we're going to buy those raw materials. That's his point. He's saying, England, you know, you're trying to, and that was the point. England wasn't trying to make the millions, or however Roosevelt said it more elegantly. It wasn't trying to make the pennies, it was using them, but the goal was to keep those countries backwards. I mean, if you've got, go back to this, go back to Prometheus, right? What was Zeus's argument? So Zeus, the king, you know, the chief god of Olympus, he was pissed off at Prometheus, because Zeus said, fire is for me, it's not for those other people. Part of my identity that makes me feel like who I am and makes me feel proud of myself is that I've got it and they don't. I'm not equal with those people. Don't give them fire. Then what makes me special? Right? How am I greater than them anymore? And that's the outlook of empire. It's that Zeus outlook that says our identity is in being better than you. Like the Project for a New American Century in the US saying America's identity is being the top power in the world. Like, it's like, well, what? Your only identity is being better than other people? Well, you should see a psychologist. You're messed up. If that's your goal in life, you're really a messed up person.
Right after the Kennedy assassination, about 66, 67, you had a group of these MIT groups. These are the predecessors to the Leibniz Growth Crowd, who put together this report called the Rappaport Report. It was a direct attack on NASA, but it wasn't without intent. They didn't say we have to save money and balance the budget. They said NASA was producing too many scientists, too many engineers, too much of an ingrained belief in the population. Mm. Progress could make life better for succeeding generations. This is what we've got to wipe out. And they did. They brought in Woodstock. They brought in broad drug sex capital. They brought in radical environmentalism. They brought this stuff in. It wasn't the same worth of dollars and cents. This was pure Zeusian oligarchic output. That's exactly what you said.
Right. The greatest threat is that people will be optimistic. That's the biggest problem with the same world. Yeah. They're going to say, if we can go to the moon, why do we have poverty? Which is, of course, a sensible thing to say. If we can go to the moon, why do we have poverty? There's no reason to have poverty anywhere on the planet. You know, it's a decision.
What's wrong with having both? Better folks.
There's another aspect of the Chinese development, which I think is extremely important, and I don't know how many people in this room know about, but they have an unprecedented construction project of opera houses and concert halls. Mm. They have hundreds of thousands of young Chinese students playing piano and all string instruments. In 1957, in China, Beethoven's Ninth Symphony was performed in Mandarin Chinese. There's a history of classical music, of Western classical music in China. I think in large part, they've also listened to LaRouche's on another matter, which is the infrastructure of the human mind. And they've placed enormous emphasis on the development of classical music throughout China. They have made major overtures. I don't know how many people in this room know a fellow by the name of Isaac Stern, who in 1949 actually got himself invited to China. He asked actually Henry Kissinger to make the arrangements, and Henry Kissinger refused. And he took his, because Isaac Stern was such an incredibly curious fellow, he found out that the Chinese ambassador was having dinner in the same apartment complex in Manhattan where Isaac Stern and his family lived, that he got himself invited to the dinner. And he arranged right then and there with the Chinese ambassador to the United States to make the trip with his entire family. When he arranged, became the big hubbub, and I forget the name of the person that intervened and said, look, can we film this? Can we make it into a movie? And so Isaac Stern and his entire family, including all his little bambinos at that time, his children, David Stern is the oldest son to accompany him and was the accompanying pianist when his father played in China in 1979. He went throughout China, and at that time, they wanted to have the Chinese students that were the best students perform for Isaac Stern. Some of those students today are now collaborators with this movement. They were 4, 5, and 6 years old at the time. The reason I bring this up is because Jason has spent, I think, what, the better part of an hour and a half, 2 hours now, talking about infrastructure. Our movement has intervened on a different level of infrastructure, which is the question of the commitment of the development of the infrastructure of the human mind, which is creativity. And I think almost everyone in this room here has come across some of our work in a 30-year history of attacking the drugs on the mind. But I think more recently, perhaps, some of you in this room have come in contact with our work on the development of classical music. And from the moment I met Mr. LaRouche, he emphasized the work of Beethoven, Mozart, Schumann, Schubert, and the discoveries that he made when he was still in uniform in World War II, when he heard a conductor by the name of Furtwängler conduct Tchaikovsky's work. He said, I had never heard Tchaikovsky in that way, and it had a profound effect on Mr. LaRouche. The reason I bring it up is because we have, in recent period, had extraordinary classical music concerts, including a tribute to John Kennedy on the 50-year anniversary of a similar tribute that Jacqueline, his widow, arranged in Boston, Massachusetts. We actually have copies of this available. I only have, unfortunately, one right here today. Subsequently, last year, this fall, in honor of those who died in the attack on the 9/11 towers, we held 4 concerts of the Mozart Requiem. On December 17th upcoming, we will be holding a concert in New York, and if anybody is actually available to go to New York, Brooklyn, we will be holding a concert in the St. Joseph's Co-Cathedral, which has been kind enough, so for those of you who can't travel, to simultaneously live broadcast this concert to the world. So it's on a website called netny.tv. So at 6 p.m. on December 17th, everyone in this room can participate in that live concert. But what I would also ask you to do is to think about it from the standpoint of opening your homes, perhaps opening your churches. If they have a live internet connection, what greater way to celebrate this period than to have you people here in this room participate in building that audience for the Handel's Messiah, and I believe there's several other pieces, the Spirit. Sections from Bach's Magnificat.
Bach it out. The Messiah, first part, and the Hallelujah chorus, because you can't leave that out.
So I'm asking everyone here, if you do have an internet connection at your home, at your church, at your business, I would ask that you collaborate with Karen Nofziger, Doug Malouk here, if you don't know me, Marsha Malouk, and others, Jerry Belsky, collaborate with us and come up with ideas so that we can have in this geographic area, Maryland, Virginia, Pennsylvania, Lititz, Pennsylvania is famous for several churches. If we could open them up and have the internet and have large audiences other than just your living room, but many people here, if you have a living room, you can ask 5 or 6 or 10 of your friends to come and participate. This is the kind of infrastructure and the kind of collaboration across cultures along the Silk Road, which in the ancient Silk Road, was absolutely critical to the success of the ancient Silk Road. It wasn't just a question of a vehicle for goods. It was a vehicle to have an understanding across cultures and across musical cultures and artistic cultures, cultural exchanges of all kinds. And so.
Thank you. That's really true. I mean, you can compare that, what you just brought about China culturally with, you know, what passes for most culture in the United States.
I mean, and I just want to say one last thing. These young people that when Isaac Stern went, he went back 20 years later, and it was also filmed. He passed away in 2005. His son David and his entire family is intimately involved in uplifting at the highest levels the classical culture of China, as are the Lucius.
The deliberate attack on culture that came in the Congress for Cultural Freedom, you know, that came in the post-World
War II period, where, you know, there was a deliberate push for an idea of a culture that rejected the idea of truth. It said that people who believe that they can know something or that something's right as opposed to wrong, that's where fascism comes from. Mm-hmm. So we got to root out fascism. You know, it's not just in Germany, it's probably everywhere. We've got to root out fascism,
they said, by getting rid of this idea of knowing things and of being right. And so they did it in a few ways. One was just by deliberately saying that. Another part of it, and this came earlier too, was the transformation of music from what it had been an occurrence up through the death of Brahms around 1900 into deliberately bad things that people were told they were supposed to like. Like, I saw one of these, it was probably a joke, but it was like a comment card from MoMA, from the Museum of Modern Art. And it was in the handwriting of a little kid. And said, "You call yourself a museum? Where's the dinosaurs? All I saw was trash on the walls and a water fountain." Now, so some of these things, like, you know, you see a urinal sitting there, or like, I don't know, a hand that's colored green and it has six fingers instead of four or something. You know, you say, well, this stuff isn't art. It's okay to just say the truth, to say what you think about some of this stuff. You compare that with somebody who actually, like, really put a lot of work into something and made something beautiful, like Da Vinci or, you know, Goya or something like that, and then you see this, you don't have to pretend, you don't have to respect it. And part of what happened with that, like with the, what was that Stravinsky, The Rite of Spring, right? This is one of the big cases. Stravinsky wrote this piece called The Rite of Spring. And it's weird, it's atonal, the rhythms are strange, it's not music, it's the strange noise that you might use in some interrogation cell in a bad place or something. And what happened was, you know, they performed it and the audience basically had a riot. People rejected it. They said, what is this garbage? We came to hear a concert. Are you guys still tuning? What is this? And so all the newspapers published reviews saying, oh, apparently the audience wasn't able to appreciate this piece of music. You see, this is a new music and maybe old-fashioned people don't get it. So we'll try it again. So another month or so, they had another performance, and this time people said, oh, so nice. That was really great. Now, those people didn't have to like it. Whether they did or not is almost irrelevant. The point was that people had to say, like, they couldn't judge it. That was the point. That was the foot in the door on some of this stuff. That you couldn't just say, that's not music. That is crap. Which nowadays, that's become the predominant idea. That you can't, well, it's all a personal interpretation. It's all taste. It's, if you like that, then you like that. You see, no, well, is it possible that there's something about the human mind and the human soul that some things are just actually beautiful and in resonance with that, and some things are just ugly or nasty or, you know, just disgusting and ugly, and that deliberately appeal to our baser aspects of ourselves? It's like maybe you can do something like that and you can get people to watch it, like some gruesome video or something like that, but is that beautiful? Is that uplifting people? Is that serving a purpose of helping to make people better? I mean, that's what art ought to do. Are we just gonna, you know, present the world as I see it? It's like, well, who cares how you see it? And maybe you've got some good insight, but if you think that your role as an artist is just to present your point of view, say, is that a good point of view? Is it a great, did you work on that point of view? Do you have a thought that you think is beautiful and will help people? Or is it just sort of your way you see things? And there's just so much room to grow in terms of saying, hey, we need to consciously create beauty. And, you know, in these concerts that Marcia was just talking about that we've been doing. I mean, these things have such an effect. I mean, that one that we did up in Boston. I mean, imagine this, 50 years after the assassination of President Kennedy, who, you know, people, you know, everyone loves Kennedy, right? Here we are 50 years after his assassination, and who in Boston is doing something? We are, yeah. So here we are in that, you know, as you said, that same church, the same day, exactly 50 years later.
There's nothing in D.C. either.
Yeah, right, and then we did it in D.C. We did it in this area, yeah. You know, so it's like, that's like a sane culture would say, hey, we need to celebrate this great president. He was killed 50 years ago. Let's honor him in a meaningful way. Let's do something beautiful for his legacy. And in this concert, we had the Mozart Requiem, which was what was performed for that service in Boston after his killing. And we included we included clips from him. What did Kennedy stand for? Including things that people today might find shocking. Like, you know, he thought dams were good.
Yeah. I think in that regard, we should point out that in that Isaac Stern film that Marshall was referring to from
Mauer and Mozart,
he discovered that they had gone through, and he saw the effect on some of the adolescents, that China had gone through a cultural revolution, which said you must destroy beauty. Anybody who was playing instruments, teaching music, was put in prison or put into a closet. And they had people interviewed who went through this. This had a profound effect. They were trying to get rid of the idea of progress, which is connected to the idea of intellectual beauty. They got out of that cultural revolution, and it was shortly after they got rid of it that Isaac Stern came. The problem here in the United States is we've been in a cultural revolution for a lot longer. I mean, in China, they knew this was wrong, and they were trying to get out of it. You look now what China is doing. But you look at the United States, when we were doing the same thing in many times in our history, but we have been in a cultural revolution for a lot longer, which is why people are told that you cannot have scientific progress, that it's bad, that the way to deal with underdeveloped nations is we should cut back development. You know, we're consuming too much in terms of the question that Neil was raising. If you're actually expanding, and this is what Hamilton showed, that if you're expanding the productive powers of labor, you're not only going to create more, you're going to consume more, more energy, more technology, right? Higher standard of living. But people are being told, we're destroying nature, it's a fixed universe, there's no progress, pretty depressing viewpoint. So not only do we need an economic revolution, but this is actually going to help produce a return to this principle of scientific progress coming from the human mind. It's going to be a cultural, this is what we mean by a paradigm shift. It's going to be a shift. So by making this change now, this discussion in Washington, how do you build infrastructure? You have to make this cultural paradigm shift. Mm-hmm.
Which I'll just say on the question of taking action on this, what's really crucial, we've gone back after from the November election, we've gone back to Washington, D.C. twice. Valerie here might want to say something because she just recently started looking at our stuff on the internet and following what we're doing, and she came last Wednesday and was very, to her credit, extremely aggressive and direct, and that is how you have to deal with these characters there. But we need people in this room on December 7th. It's Pearl Harbor Day. I think it's an appropriate day to return to Washington. Is that we need people signing up. If you could go even for an hour or 2 hours. This past Wednesday, I think our teams, we had 3, 4, 5 teams going in different offices, but they had virtually nonstop meetings. The one thing is you do have to be able to walk, and you want to wear extremely comfortable shoes. If you have a hard time walking, it's a little bit difficult to handle. But people in here will have a sign-up sheet. People should sign up to come. You can, if you know Jerry, Karen, Doug, myself, you know, if you talk to us on the phone, we would really love to have you. If anyone wants to go from our Baltimore office, you just have to be there by 8:30. It's a very easy office to find. You can also rendezvous with us down on Capitol Hill. It's Independence and New Jersey Avenue. And Jerry can tell you where to park, so it won't cost you an arm and a leg if you want to come in that way. But we really need new people. It's really, it changes the whole dynamic of our teams. Many people are seasoned and they've gone back over and over with us, but I'll tell you something, when our teams see new faces, it changes the dynamic. When you walk into the congressional office and new people speak up, it changes the dynamic.
Mark, Marsh, let me add something to that, because most of the meetings that we're getting now are being organized by constituents. So the good thing to do is to get in touch with Marsha, Doug, Karen, Jerry, and get a meeting set up with your representative. Because that's how these things are happening. If it's someone that lives in their district, they're setting them up.
But the other thing is that we really need everyone in this room getting their friends and family and neighbors, going to the LaRouche PAC website, being in direct contact with our office in Baltimore. I passed out a few of my business cards to people in this room. Our office is so easy to come to. And it's not just our office, it's your office. You can come in and work with us for an hour, 2 hours. If you have Monday nights free, Karen here leads a choral group. And I know that there's a few people in here that have classical music training that I have not seen on Monday nights at 8 o'clock. And we would love to have you join us. And it is obviously all volunteer, and you'll have fun. And for those that think they can't sing, we'll prove you wrong as long as you want to learn.
I'll let Mel read too.
Oh, you can tell I'm going to say something. I'm kind of wiggling. There is a big urgency, and I was trying to stress that the other day because I think they're just so complacent and they're not thinking. And they seem to look to someone else to make decisions for them, and it's usually their leader. And they're just, like I said, complacent. And they don't understand or realize the urgency in which we really do have to move, because we are being left behind. As you see, that obviously China and Russia are already working on this, and it was LaRouche's idea to begin with, and we can't even get it done in our own country.
Amen.
And so we need Glass-Steagall. We need the big cartel banks to stop overpowering us and trying to run this country. That's what we need. We need stability, number one. And then, of course, everything else. There's New Silk Road and the poor laws. But we need to get that point across to the people in the capital. And the only way we're going to do that is if everybody can call their representatives and get a meeting set up so that we can go there and be more aggressive, because that's what we have to do.
Amen, sister.
I just want to say one other thing. You're absolutely right, Mallory. And people may have more questions. I don't want to stop the questions, but I just want to point out, at the literature table, we have all sorts of literature that people can take, including the exact legislation for a national bank to produce this type of economic recovery. We have the 4 reports of Hamilton we're getting out for $10, which he actually wrote to take a country that was bankrupt to become the most productive nation in the world, which is the model, really, for what you see going on with the New Silk Road. This was 200 years ago. So, in fact, when I was in Congress 2 weeks ago, I ran into a congressman, because they wear these pins, you know who they are, and I started talking about how Hamilton had showed you could get out of bankruptcy. And this guy actually surprised me, because he actually had read Hamilton, one of the few. I was glad to meet someone in Congress who read Hamilton. But they should all read Hamilton. He wrote Report on Manufacturing, Report on Public Credit, Report on a National Bank. So we could do this right now. We have the basis. What's that?
Everybody here should
read. Absolutely. Yeah, everybody should know this.
We read it Saturday, most Saturdays at 8 o'clock.
Yeah. 6 o'clock in our office. We're having Saturdays readings of these reports to go through them.
I mean, this should be well known to everybody, yet very few people know that Hamilton showed you can. See, here's the big debate in Washington on this that I saw came up, which is, okay, we want $1 trillion in infrastructure, and they're still talking about just repairing, you know, roads, but how are you going to build that? So one school of thought is, especially among the Republicans, well, if you're going to spend $1 trillion and you're going to borrow money, then you better cut another trillion out of the budget. So that's going to really do good. That's one proposal. The other proposal is we have to get people with money to give us the money. We'll give them tax breaks. So that's going to go back to the toll roads. So Hamilton solves that problem. So I urge people to get a copy of this. We also have, as we pointed out, the actual report, the full report on the New Silk Road Becomes the World Land Bridge. If people would like to purchase a copy, this is $50. We also have this one we've been getting out for $20 on how would we get America into the Silk Road. I mean, that requires some real breakthroughs, like Jason was talking about. So we'll have a sign-up sheet at the end for people who want to go to Washington on Wednesday. This is the last chance before the inauguration and the new Congress to sit down. And I will point out to you, many of these offices did want, at least, they felt compelled to meet with us because we just had an election where they were told, you know, we don't want either party. So they want to know, many of them, okay, what do you guys have to say? Because maybe you know something we don't know.
No, maybe not.
If anyone wants a copy of the Land Bridge Report, you have a CD. Hey, Bob, you want to ask a question?
Yeah, I wanted to say something about the solar. I heated my house for 20 years with solar. That was very basic. I mean, they've come a long way with it, and I think probably not trying to depend on going totally with nuclear, I think, is the best way to go. But you have a lot of people that have problems with, I don't want that nuclear plant near me. And you don't have that with the solar, so I don't see any reason why.
Yeah, plus they get a big tax break for putting it on their roofs, right? Yeah. And it's all subsidized by the government, right? Yeah. So if you didn't have that, nobody would have solar.
They can put a nuclear plant back in my backyard.
But what they've done is, Nevada is a classic example. Nevada has made it to the point now because of the co-op lobby that it is not any benefit, even with the rebates and the tax credits, to have solar on your roof.
Right. Well, as far as the nuclear fear goes, I mean, you want to talk about something that's just been deliberately promoted, it makes no sense at all.
Yeah.
I mean, just that people are concerned about nuclear power and don't even know what's going on inside of that. It's like people, it's amazing the extent that people have opinions on things they just have no business even having an opinion on. I mean, it's one thing if you actually studied on it and you come to a conclusion, and you say, well, I've heard, or most people say, or many people are afraid, or whatever. You know, it's like, okay.
You take the average, like, 9-year-old, and they'll tell you that carbon dioxide created by people is heating the planet. Now, they're 9. They don't really know much of anything when you're 9. I didn't in particular. I mean, maybe you know you've done some things, you know, that baking soda and vinegar makes some fizz. Maybe you've done some experiments with dropping things or whatever. You don't know how the globe operates. So I'm saying, you know, if we've got a society where it's considered normal to say, you know, as a 9-year-old that you understand this sort of very complex phenomenon, it's a little bit bizarre. It's just not, it can't even be based on knowing something. And so like you get that with nuclear. It's just sort of a sense of, I think it's bad, you know.
Well, I mean, you
threw
my
bottle. And that's the worst that ever happened and no one even got hurt. I mean,
well,
right?
The worst that ever happened is, that was a really bad thing that happened as far as the people's, look towards nuclear, because if you've ever flown out of the Harrisburg Airport, you fly right over that.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, they weren't really smart when they placed that on the Silk Road.
Well, the other thing is that
I mean, the technology, the chance of that thing or Chernobyl or any of them happening again is probably nil.
Yeah, I mean, like
not one plant in the U.S. is designed like the Chernobyl. What happened there just could not happen. And yeah, I mean, a lot of these things is like 40 years old.
We've developed. And with solar, the power does not go back in the grid. Never makes the grid. It goes into the community. I've done a lot of research on that.
Not only do we not have the Chernobyl design, they overrode safeties for hours.
You're saying in the Three Mile Island one, or
Chernobyl, they were doing a grid power test, and they would rather tell. They were more afraid of telling Moscow no than overriding safety.
Oh.
And so they overrode them for hours. The plant tried to shut itself down, and then it was a hydrogen explosion because when they tried to shut it down, the water flashed to hydrogen and oxygen, and the hydrogen exploded. It had nothing to do with a nuclear meltdown. But when you have a hydrogen explosion in a nuclear power plant, you release radiation. But there's a series of things. It had
some significant operator.
Well, they really overrode safety for hours.
I listened this week to Putin's State of the State address. You have a chance to speak?
I read it, yeah.
Yeah. Because, the one thing he addressed on the question of education is very beautiful, because he's addressing the question of every child having the potential to make a contribution, and we have to educate all children from that standpoint. But stepping back from it afterwards and thinking about what he had done in that speech, because he goes through the economic problems and developments and so forth, it seemed to me this was an honest presentation to the people of Russia of the situation in Russia. Here's where we've made progress. Here's where we have problems. We haven't solved this. We haven't solved that. We have to do this. But he was addressing the nation as a whole on, here's how we need you to think about it and participate in continuing progress. And I was thinking about it from the standpoint of the contrast to a State of the Union speech in the United States of America, where you get a president who gets up there, at least over the last 16 years, and they just tell you a bunch of bullshit about all the great things they've done.
That they're going to do, which they never do.
And the Congress jumps up 50 times to give them a standing ovation, right? And none of it's true. And it's just kind of, it's a question of real leadership as opposed to what we've had for such a long time, which is just bullshit. I don't know if you have anything to say about it, but...
Well, it's kind of funny, just on the, in terms of leadership, it's sort of ironic that here we've got Donald Trump, Republican, who's won the presidency, and he's saying, hey, let's spend $1 trillion on infrastructure. Now, most people would say, oh, that seems like the sort of Franklin Roosevelt Democratic kind of party no-brainer. Why did Obama never do something like that? Right. There's the Stimulus Act, which if anybody can name, two things that were built by the Stimulus Act, you get a prize. You compare that to the New Deal.
Everyone you can name, the Golden Gate Bridge, the Grand Coulee Dam, the Hoover, these are big things, right? So in terms of it being wide open for us to provide that kind of leadership. I mean, I think that one thing we're talking about, one thing you see when you go to Congress is you see how much you're needed. It's sort of, if you've never been there, and then you go there and you see these people and you say, whoa, these are the people running the country. Woo! You realize that you have personally got some work to do. Because they don't, if they knew what they were doing, it wouldn't be the situation it's in right now. So it's a real eye-opener. And, don't be bashful about going. Go, even if you're afraid of talking in public, maybe you can just look emphatic or something, but you'll probably get angry enough to say something. But we've got to provide that leadership. It's just not coming from the top. People said, oh great, Bush is gone. Thank goodness. People were, relieved by that. And then you say, oh good, Obama, I'm sure something good will happen now. Democrat, great, wonderful. Well, maybe next year something really, okay, maybe we'll get the, and what did we get? The Affordable Care Act, that was like the big thing. And it's like, that's the big victory? That's what we got? How about Glass-Steagall? Why didn't you do that first thing, huh? So just, we got it. We it's up to us. We really do have to make this happen. We got to push, you got to be active. You vote once every 4 years for president. There's 1,460 days in between. You can do something every one of those days. You don't have to wait for day 1,460, right? So, and look, and that's really an issue. If people's relationship to what's going on in the country is to vote. I'm not saying you shouldn't vote, but you can't, if you, that's all you do, what kind of citizen are you? I mean, we're a country that depends on people actually being involved in these kinds of things, not just voting for, you know, whoever wound up on the ballot by some means. Well, I guess we're the teachers.
There's a lot of stuff that with regarding financing, because I think this is a big problem right now with both parties, because whenever and also it has to do with a lot of African countries too, because right now, firstly, when we get Glass-Steagall in, I think Lynn has been saying all along that we have to get it international. Mm-hmm. Because you look at the currencies of both African countries right now, and also maybe in good America, getting devalued in a very great way, which really doesn't allow these African countries to really embark on projects. Like Buhari, for example, he said he didn't want to take any money from the IMF. He was strenuously saying, no. And then all of a sudden I hear that he now agreed, and IMF said, yes, you know, you're going to take this money, but now you're going to have to devalue your currency. By, like, just imagine, you have 300 naira, and you're going to exchange it for $1. I mean, that really gets very difficult to embark on the type of changes that is needed right now. So on the first part, we do need to get Glass-Steagall in, but at the same time, how are we going to address to get it international? Because the currencies right now, as they stand, is really dismal to the US dollar right now. Because I remember when Lynn was saying back in the 70s, most African countries and Ibero-American currencies were 1-to-1 with the US dollar. Now it's down in the tank right now. Like, for example, in Zimbabwe, I think it's like, I don't know how much it is right now. It's really like, you can take, for example, in Ghana at one point, it was like you have to have like six, the currency in Ghana is a CD. And at one point, you have to have 6,000 CDs for $1. So it's true that what she was saying, that this is deliberate. I mean, to keep countries down, keep them impoverished, don't develop them. I mean, it's really, really getting to the point. So, because, and then the question on financing, what Trump was saying about user fees and all that kind of stuff, is that both political parties would say, oh yeah, if we do that, we're gonna run a deficit. And, you know, the deficit thing has been going on for both political parties. And I think that's something that most people, even most political parties, seem to understand, that it was through Hamilton that I learned that it's good to have debt. But, you know, because they like the understanding that if you have debt, you invest it in the fiscal economy, you know, in fiscal investment. So I was just thinking that how do we try to, number one, how do we get Glass-Steagall, and how do we bring these currencies, like in Africa, you know, global countries, back to par so that they can be into it? And it's going to take some time, but how do we begin that process? Also, on public financing, one thing I was trying to understand is that while Paul was saying something about the National Bank being in cooperation with the BRICS countries, and he was saying something regarding to loans, also, I didn't really understand that, so I'll just see if you could just...
Okay. Well, so first off, on the IMF, I mean, the IMF and the World Bank are called, they're called Bretton Woods institutions. They were set up back in the Bretton Woods Conference after World War II. There's a book, Confessions of an Economic Hitman, probably familiar with, by John Perkins. And he described how the IMF would get countries into debt or to take loans, not to get paid back, but in order to then control their finances. So they'll give you a loan, but you know, if you don't like the way you run your country, you're probably not going to pay us back.
So we'll only give you the loan if you reduce that subsidy you're giving on heating oil. Because it's just bad to have a subsidy on heating oil. You know, people might be too warm. So then we'll give you the loan if you do that. And, you know, they would even force loans on countries to be able to get. And it wasn't about building the projects, although sometimes they get built. It was about getting financial control over these nations. And so that's something that, you know, the AIIB and the New Development Bank, the BRICS New Development Bank and the Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, they've been completely explicit. The leaders of those banks have, you know, they've contrasted themselves with the World Bank and the IMF. And, you know, they've said, we're not into conditionalities. We're not going to do that. So I think it's representative of the new paradigm that's taking hold right now. I mean, you've got this transatlantic, European, U.S., you know, IMF, you know, a 70-year-old institution that's not doing anything very good right, you know, doing bad and has been for decades, where they refuse to change the voting rules, for example, to give China a bigger say. They just would not, you know, they're just saying that this is what we're going to operate with it. And you contrast that with what's happening instead now, where countries are just saying, hey, great, we got some financing, like that rail line in Ethiopia, you know? It's like, the IMF would never have paid for that. Forget it. And if they did, it would have come with a list of 50 new things to do inside the country, like put Christine Lagarde on their flag and on their money, and, you know, I don't know. See, I'm just kidding. And on budgeting and debt, and that's one thing about a capital budget or a separate way of financing things, because the National Bank wasn't part of the federal budget. Right, the Hamiltonian National Bank, John Quincy Adams with the Second National Bank. It was not the same thing as the budget that was the year-to-year operating of the country. Eisenhower sort of did this with the freeways. He said, okay, we're going to set up the national freeway system, and it's paid for by this gas tax, which then goes into a separate fund to help, you know, keep it going and to expand it and to maintain it. So it was sort of taken outside of the year-to-year sort of thing. In that way, it also, some of the stuff about getting out of debt, it's like, look, if you're massively in the red, you're totally unproductive, you're going into more and more debt next year, you can't always fix that by spending less money and saying, okay, I'm only going to eat potatoes and nothing else for a whole year, you know, potatoes and ramen or whatever. You just, you know, you can't get below a certain point. So you say, well, how are you going to create growth? Right, what is going to possibly pay for any of this stuff? And even if you have maintained debt for a long time, really, it's not that big a deal. Andrew Jackson, right? He said, "Oh, debt's a bad thing." So he paid off all this debt, and he destroyed the economy in the process because instead of expanding the country, he said, "We're going to pay off all this debt." It was a disaster.
In Greece, just recently, I remember the report where they admitted that for every $1 in budget cuts, productivity collapsed by $1.50. Instead of the 50 cents that they had to spend. So the more they cut, the more they got into debt. And so, of course, what the recommendation was, there's more cuts.
Yeah. Well, for a $1 cut, they lose $1.50. Maybe it'll be different for a $2 cut.
Right. Good.
Yeah. Yeah. Maybe they have a job for me. No, it's so blatant. I mean, the only thing with the IMF.
The same with Greece. They're just trying to somehow make it look like Greece is continuing to make payments on its debt so that all that debt doesn't get devalued. Because that debt is held by all these banks. And if that debt, which they're pretending is worth its full value, everyone says, oh, of course, Greece will end up paying all of this back. There's a plan.
It'll all be fine. As soon as they have to admit, you know what? They're not going to pay this debt. Then what about all the derivatives that they've based on that? I mean, this, you know, you just gets into huge, huge sums of money where the whole banking system would collapse. So that, in addition to just trying to, you know, destroy Greece and, you know, make countries less productive, which is something they've been doing, it's also, that's the other aspect of it, is this financial thing of keeping the debt supposedly worth its full value.
Ugh. Too bad we didn't have our own media, because we really needed it. Because all we fed is propaganda, and we're taught to think a certain way, and we're lied to, so we are constantly hearing from every single echo chamber, and every single, now newspapers have been bought up in order to spew the propaganda, the agenda that they want you to believe, and that's look at what's happened.
That's media stuff. It's funny. It's bizarre that some people pretend that the media is unbiased, or even that it should be unbiased. I mean, no one's unbiased. Give me a break. Why pretend, right? You know, you got an agenda, that's fine, you know? But it's like, well, what, are you trying to do something good? I mean, for example, you know, we put out a newspaper. We got a website. We've got updates. We got things. You know, this is like our news, so to speak. We produce this stuff because we're trying to make things better.
We have a goal of what we want to do, and we need to know what's going on to make that happen. Like, that's, you know, that's a legitimate reason for having news, you know. But yeah, you're right, it's just don't watch it, you know. You get Fox News and you get somebody yelling about how the Democrats are all Satan, and you get Rachel Maddow screaming about how the Republicans are all Satan, and it's like, okay, well, thanks, that was really helpful, thanks.
Jason, we recently
lifted blast. Can you say more about that?
You mean that they've never lost that?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Like, for example, you saw it, like, what was this, a couple years ago, there was a big drop in the Chinese stock market. And it really didn't have that much of an effect on the economy in China because people are way less connected with it. Well, the banks are just much more regulated there. I mean, it's not,
you know, they just, I'm not really sure what I could say, but well, they don't have universal banking in China.
Well, it comes up because I know that they seem to have two currencies, the renminbi and the yuan. And I don't completely understand how that, I mean, whether in fact they use that to isolate so that they develop themselves internally more rapidly. Is that the system that we used to use before we had Glass-Steagall?
Well, we used to have a control over the currency where, I mean, there didn't used to be dollars that just existed all over the world in banks or as
paper dollars. It used to be much more, you know, you'd only have, under the, initially under the Bretton Woods institutions, the only dollars that would exist, it would be related, maybe a company that deals with the U.S. in some sort of trade or whatever, they would, through their national bank, get dollars for settling trade between the two countries.
Right, but there weren't just dollars sitting out there. You know, each country had its own currency. And also, you know, Kunle, you know, initially under the Bretton Woods system, well, until 71, you know, the currencies were, they didn't move around. Mm-hmm. The currencies involved in this, the exchange rates were fixed. So if you're making a deal with another country, mm-hmm. like you bring up, like let's say take an African country that its currency is devalued, if they got a loan to build something and the loan came in dollars, and they say, well, you got to pay us back in dollars. That loan just went up 10 times. If you got, you know, in terms of your local currency. Yeah, exactly. Once it, now that it's floating, so now you devalue a currency like that, all of the debt that's denominated in another currency just skyrockets. It's totally unpayable. And then people start having to worry about, well, might they change? And then people start having to buy, you know, insurance against a changing interest rate and all this kind of stuff. Whereas if they're just not moving around all the time, you don't have to worry about all that kind of nonsense. It makes it much easier to do a long-term. So I don't know if China has any sort of long-term currency controls, like let's say with Kazakhstan. Like does China keep their currency so that, you know, they try to keep it, you know, pretty much at some sort of level with Kazakh currency? Yeah.
That they don't allow their currency to be devalued.
Yeah, China doesn't float its currency.
Yeah, so the U.S. is constantly criticizing.
They're saying, well, that's why Chinese imports here, you know, because China is, right. So the U.S. says China should increase, you know, let the value of its currency increase, and it's too low, et cetera, et cetera.
Is that why Trump is saying that China is a currency manipulator or something?
If he said that, that might be why. It's hard to always know why Trump says something that he says, but I can. going out on a limb here, you know. But yeah, so like when I don't know what currencies China is using, for example, when it does one of these deals, like that rail line in Ethiopia, for example. What currency is that being paid back in? Dollars, renminbi, Ethiopian currency? I just don't know. But it's a good point. If you're going to have stable things like that with another country over 20 years, yeah, or if you're going to build a big project like that, because you're doing trade, you say, well, maybe the value of it changes while it's on the boat. Okay, you know, that's some risk, but if you're being paid back over 20 years, that's a huge, if the currency might move around, that's a big kind of gamble if it's all floating around. I don't know how to handle it. I think that goes to this global Glass-Steagall idea, you know.
Yeah. One company that I've heard from people, especially African countries, what they say is that when China tries to build a project, that China doesn't use or they say that China doesn't train native workers, that they always use their own workers, and then when the project is done, the workers leave, that they don't try to train engineers in Africa like that in another country to do something. That's one complaint I've heard that they don't.
Yeah.
They like it, but they don't. They say China, the criticism that I've heard, that China doesn't try to employ, you know, the country where they're engaged in to learn or to train or to build something like that. I don't know how true that is.
It is something that goes around, and I think maybe some of the higher level positions, like engineering or whatever, you know, that might all be Chinese, I know, but I know that, most of the workers on that Ethiopian line, for example, I believe were Chinese, Ethiopian, we were wrong about that.
Yeah, it's not as truly sweet.
It's one of the, I don't know many numbers for other projects, but China knows that that's something that's being said against them, and I think it's being sensitive too.
But I mean, if you're building all these things, I mean, you don't have that many, you're only so many people in China. It's a lot, but still, you know, you just have people already there can do it, you know.
I should just mention that we have at the table a DVD of Jason interviewing Paul Gallagher on how do you finance this recovery. So a lot of the questions about how you're going to be able to set up a national bank, launch long-term projects, and how does this relate to Glass-Steagall? Because you can't do this unless you first break the power of Wall Street. They can't control the money and the credit. So that if anybody wants to contribute, just
get a DVD on this. It also has Helga's description of what this new paradigm looks like. So it's all on this this one DVD.
I would like to say something about that, because shortly after Thanksgiving, this organization in the U.S. and people, because I'm involved in asking people here for financial support, we have set a goal in 4 weeks to raise $280,000, which is $70,000 a week. Many weeks in order to operate, we come in short, and we have come in short repeatedly. If anyone here is in a position to make a larger contribution to help that, we're trying to fight even today to. I don't think we're going to hit 70,000 this week. We're fighting to come up with 60,000 this week. So we won't be on target for the first week. We'll be $10,000 short. If there are people who would be willing to make larger contributions and want to discuss it in private, I am available right now 24/7, including tomorrow, if you want to call me on my cell phone. In the evening, anybody wants to continue to discuss in private, because I don't like to discuss anyone's finances in a public meeting. I think it's it's better that it's between you and me. And some people can, in the past have made contributions of $10,000 and $5,000. That's extremely generous. We understand that not everyone is in that financial condition, given what's happened to the United States over the last 16 years. But we do need larger contributions from individuals in order to hit this $280,000 goal. That's one of the things that I mentioned, this concert. It does take resources to produce materials, even with our tables. Many of you over years have met us or seen us repeatedly. I know Noel, I know Pierre have met us repeatedly at tables at various deployments in Washington, D.C., Prince George's County, Montgomery County. In order for us to get our men and women out to those tables, we need resources. What's that?
Reprint the pamphlet.
We need to reprint the pamphlet, and to be very blunt about it, it's tragic, but we have not delivered this to individual members of the House and the United States Senate. And politically, right now, not to do that, I find very objectionable. We have to do it. But in order to produce this document, it is expensive. So again, I just make an appeal to you. If you want to discuss with me or with Karen or Doug, larger contributions, we will make ourselves available.
Or even not so large.
Or even not so large. And as I said, this week, the first week of a 4-week offensive, we are struggling to hit 60,000. So anything that you can do this evening or tomorrow or next week would be very much appreciated. And I just want to say everyone I think here should join in thanking Jason for his time, and Valerie. Everyone should do what Valerie did on Wednesday, and I hope she comes back this Wednesday with us.
Oh,
Well, I am indeed a strong supporter of nuclear energy, and it should definitely be reinvested in our society. Although nuclear energy tends to be more of a base load power, something you just keep running constantly. It's something that should be ran day to day to day and so forth. But what about the place that hydropower dams would play in a future society? Of course, it has roles in agriculture and flooding, irrigation, and that's important. But what about having more hydroelectric dams and improving those across the country? Because there's about 5,000-6,000 dams total, I think, in the United States, and the vast majority of them don't actually produce any power. I mean, they have, of course, uses in irrigation and so forth, but a lot of those could actually be electrified and do more than just provide water. And I believe if you were to have this hydro-nuclear alliance, then you really wouldn't have to deal with the nonsense of windmills and solar panels.
Well, I don't know, you know, all the nation's rivers or how much more hydropower we could get. I mean, hydropower is great. It's very, very expensive.
Yeah, it's very cheap.
Yeah. You know, that's like Iceland, for example. They get all their power from geothermal and hydro. And it's so inexpensive that they do a lot of aluminum production there, which requires a lot of electricity. So it's like a major, who would guess, right? Major, you know, industry of Iceland is making aluminum because they got really cheap power. I'll have to get back to you on that, though.
I don't know. I mean, not every dam is suitable for, you know, a hydro dam if it's only like 10 feet tall, you know. But
all of them. Like a chunk of them could be, but there's still many that just can't be converted.
Yeah, I can't answer you, but that's a good question. Okay.